Yeah. There he is. He flew down a branch. What do you think his sign was when he squawked?
He was wishing us luck.
Well, he just flew away. It really doesn't help to have the sun in your eyes when you're filming. Oh my God. It just blew my ear out. Yeah, go get your yogurt. Doug, leave everything on.
I don't want to lose
it. No, leave it on. It's okay. I'm waiting for the star to come out.
Can you still hear me?
Of course, I can hear you clear as a bell.
Good.
Well, this is going to be a lovely film of you eating lunch.
It is Friday, February 14, 2014.
Okay.
This is Los Angeles, or rather, Westlake Village, California, about 40 miles from LA.
Now, how did a boy from Paris, France end up here?
That's a very long question. Could take more than an hour to answer it.
Good. We need an hour.
Why do you want to start it? Well, I was born of a French mother and an American father. So being a binational is something that was ingrained in me from birth. And as a child, I wasn't raised by my father for a very long time because he divorced my mother when I was about 5 or 6, and went back to the U.S. We used to live in Paris or near Paris, so he went back to the U.S. and so then I was raised by my mother strictly. But she insisted that we speak English sometimes at dinner. My first trip to the U.S. was 1964, I guess, taking a ship from Rotterdam, Holland, to New York, and arriving in New York at dawn and getting the famous spectacle, this famous vision of Manhattan coming out of a fog. It's like 5 or 6 in the morning. So after spending a week in Washington, D.C. with my father, I started a tour of the country on Greyhounds, and being a foreigner and hitchhiking your way was viewed as cool, and people were still very naive and earnest in the heartland. Seeing a foreigner, they were, oh wow, they never met a Frenchman, and a Frenchman hitchhiking his way. They were in awe. It's like you were almost like a celebrity. You were invited to dinner and restaurant and diners, you know, everybody got excited. Oh, he's coming from Paris, can you imagine? So that was kind of fun. Girls liked that too. It was definitely a plus. Well, I wanted in Texas, in Dallas, I wanted to check the, I was very much into the Kennedy conspiracy theories and so on. Kennedy had died in November a year before. Then I went up to Amarillo, which was on the Route 66. I can't remember if at the time it was already a mythical route, but I left Amarillo and then for Los Angeles, going through New Mexico and Arizona, and I remember loving those two states, the nature, the landscapes, not being crazy about some of the reservations. I went to a couple of reservations, and as it was the summer, the Indians would do dances for tourists, and I remember thinking that was uncool, that was not right. And, you know, you'd pay them to dance, and it was like trained monkeys. Not a pleasant thing. But the landscape was, the land was so incredibly beautiful. Then got to L.A., was not impressed by L.A. I was staying in downtown, and downtown was really sleazy. In 1964, it was all porn shops and stuff like that. Then went up Route 1 to San Francisco, and that was gorgeous. And I remember loving San Francisco. All Europeans have kind of a love at first sight for San Francisco. And at least in those days, you were either for San Francisco or for LA. Actually, most people were for San Francisco, loved San Francisco. Then I made my way to Chicago and back to the East Coast. So that was my first American experience. My grandparents were diplomats. My mother was working for NATO. My father was a journalist, and he covered the colonial wars in the 50s. Then became was attached to the U.S. Congress and reported on the Congress for U.S. News and World Report. So everybody was in the area of world politics, international politics. I happened to have like a major revelation when two in a row, actually. I think it was late 1959, early 1960, when Citizen Kane was revived in Paris, and went to see the film at the Studio Comartin near the opera, and was so impressed that I stayed at the next show and watched it twice. And thought, wow, this is the greatest thing I've seen. That's the art of a century. You know, the way it happens in LA is you never get an immediate no. You know, it's like people, oh, sounds like they're interesting. Let me call you back, you know. But this is a good project. We love that concept, et cetera, et cetera. And then, you know, it takes a long time before you actually realize that they have absolutely no intention of doing it. And they're just afraid that they may lose on something if they don't stay with you, you know. And at the time, there were like famous stories, like people, like I think it was Columbia had passed on E.T. I mean, some great projects that made tons of money had been nixed by various production executives at the studio. So everybody was very concerned about saying you didn't say no, you know, and so everybody was tapping you on the back and giving you encouragement, even if they had no intention of following up on that. Well, I mean, quickly I realized that the house where we were staying in was, you know, didn't make sense for a bachelor. Like I was a bachelor again, so that didn't make sense to have the house we had on Veterans. So. At the same time, I think I was approached by a Belgian filmmaker who had a house in Bel Air and was looking for a roommate. And I really liked the other roommate, Terry, and so I moved in with them, and it was like a different kind of setup. But great location, because I don't think there's any better location than Mulholland Drive, especially that section near Beverly Glen, was so easy to go everywhere, and people loved coming to the house or coming to the Beverly Glen Center for lunch. So things started picking up there because it was like an industry waterhole, if you will. One day we were doing a screening at the house, and guess who shows up with her boyfriend? Carol. And it was about, the screening was about dolphins. And it was animated films about dolphins. And she happened to be writing a script about dolphins and at the time. So that was her reason for coming. And her boyfriend was a friend of one of my roommates. And, you know, during the film, I spotted her immediately. And after the film was over, I heard she needed some wine. She was asking for, has anybody got the bottle of wine or something? And as a Frenchman, I immediately reacted and brought her a glass of wine. We talked. I got her phone numbers, plural, and totally ignored the fact that she had come with her boyfriend. And so the next day I call at her house, and I get the boyfriend, and he claims he's going to give her the message that I called, and in 24 hours nothing happened. So I realized that he was never going to deliver that message. So the next day, 40 years later, I call her office, and that's how we started a relationship.
Alrighty.
Take one. Scene one.
So this is, tell me now.
Yeah, she's being, but.
This is awesome. Congratulations,
thank
Sadie.
You, baby.
Ow, my God. I just kissed you and it shocked my lips from your hair.
Oh, my God. So much electricity.
Hard. Oh, my God.
Michael Brooks is a wonderful panoramic portrait filled with individuals, their dreams, their drives, their artistic gestures, some of whom he knows well or knew when they were alive, all of them in a grand and endless conversation with one another, conducted across the years and the decades in images and sounds. In Truffaut's film, Montag admits to his wife, quote, "These books are my family." And so the American filmmakers in Apport du Paradis are also members of one grand family, along with the films we've all made. Let's say that in the end, Michael Henry Wilson's beautifully written and detailed book is the story of the family of American cinema, still alive, thriving, and growing by the minute.
Wow.
Signed, Martin Scorsese.
Okay.
Couldn't be better.
Say one last thing. What would you like to say to your cinematographer?
Good luck. I hope you're prepared for a hard-dress shoot in Burma starting 10 days from now.
Okay.
Happy and happy Valentine too.
Happy Valentine, sweetie.
Bye.
The long and winding road that leads to your door will never disappear. I've seen that road before.
A long, long time.